Welcome to Madrid, Dr. Fages. Welcome to the Juan March Foundation. We feel truly honored to have you here to open this brand new Cosmopolitan Dialogues. I have been a reader of your books for many, many years, and now I feel very privileged to share 1 hour with the man behind the books.
Thank you.
I'm sure that you have many loyal and admiring readers among the audience today.
Lovely.
I guess that an expert in Russia and in Russian history must be one of the most sought after scholars nowadays to explain what's going on, to make us understand what is going on presently in the world. But before going to the present, we are moving back to the past. And I want first to go back to Cambridge. You are a Londoner. You were born in London. This was your college, Gonville and Keys, in Cambridge, which has a magnificent library. We can imagine you studying and reading there some years ago. And the first question I want to ask, because I think it's interesting for the audience, is as a person born in London and educated in Cambridge, why Russia? Which triggered your interest in Russia and in Russian history?
There's absolutely no good reason for it. I mean, I have no Russian family. I have no particular connection to Russia. And it was a purely accidental turn in my life because I had originally, you know, I wrote an undergraduate dissertation which was published in the Leo Beck Institute yearbook in 1984. And it was my original interest, which was German-Jewish intellectual history around the time of the young Marx. So I was particularly interested in a rather obscure German writer called Ludwig Werner, whose work I thought was in some way a presaging of Marx's writings about Judaism. So I was all set to go off to Oxford, where I was being encouraged by the great Isaiah Berlin. And I thought that I was going to dedicate my life to these young Hegelians. But my supervisor at Keyes then was the historian Norman Stone, who was this larger-than-life figure, a brilliant man, but unfortunately quite a heavy drinker and known to be a womanizer, and from Glasgow. And he said to me, you know, Orlando, if you got a hangover, you drunk too much, or you've got troubles with your girlfriend, you don't want to go into the library every day and battle with Hegel. So he advised me to do something empirical, and why not Russian peasants? And that was my, I thought, why not? Uh-huh. They were going to give me, they gave the college, I went from Keyes to Trinity next door. Trinity gave me a
which
language.
Is this one?
Oh, yes, thank you, yes. That's God, it's like that TV
it's
show.
It's like a miracle,
In Britain, there's this TV show, probably American in origin, called This Is Your Life. It's a sort of nightmare, because at the end, someone comes up like your old school teacher. You're not going to bring on a school teacher, are you? They offered me a language scholarship. I went to Kyiv, the Soviet Union, in 1983 for 6 weeks to, you know, do a bit of work on my language, and then went back as a British Council exchange student in 1984 for the first of what turned out to be 3 years of archive work in Moscow, basically. Yeah. So that was me.
And then you got this research fellowship from Trinity.
Indeed.
And then you wrote your PhD, whose title was The Middle Volga Peasantry in the Russian Civil War.
Indeed.
And part of this doctoral dissertation became
your first book. My God, yes.
Which is this one.
That's hard to find these days, yeah. So I think my first sort of grounding in Russia was in the peasantry. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think that's really stood me in good stead. I think it's the rock on which all scholarship of Russian history should be based, probably, because the peasantry is, you know, was until collectivization, 80% of the population. And To understand Russia in any sense, you have to start from the soil. Mm-hmm. You have to start from, even if they're no longer peasants, but they're workers or merchants or members of the intelligentsia, whatever. I mean, the peasant world is one that they all had to inhabit. Mm-hmm. This was a peasant society, fundamentally. Not unlike Spain in the 19th century.
And the support of the peasants was crucial for the triumph of the Bolsheviks, which is one of the points. I mean, without that support.
I mean, I went to Moscow really interested in a group of peasant uprisings against the Bolsheviks. Mm-hmm. But of course, you couldn't say that in the Moscow of the 1980s. I mean, so I had to disguise my work. Mm-hmm. And that's why it got this title, The Middle Volga Peasantry in the Russian Civil War. And basically, my contacts in Russia, I mean, most of them were members of the intelligentsia who thought it was very funny that this Englishman was studying the peasantry, because their attitude to the peasantry was sort of Chekhovian. It was like those figures in Chekhov plays who think of the peasants as the serfs and the servants, but don't take them seriously as human beings or a society. and that was basically the intelligentsia view of the peasantry. Then there was a sort of mild, slightly, I don't know, a mild disbelief that this man was coming into the archives to study this subject. You had to have a научный руководитель, a supervisor, and they assigned me one at Moscow University, who was so old he was actually a partisan in the Civil War. So he wasn't much use, but my real mentor there was a great Soviet historian of collectivization and the Soviet peasantry, Viktor Petrovich Danilov. And in the UK, my contact to him was through the great rural sociologist, Theodore Shannon, who'd rediscovered, or he dealt seriously in a scholarly way with the theories of Chayanov, who was an important economist who was really the first to break the Marxist hold on the understanding of the peasantry. The Marxists really understood the peasants very poorly. Lenin's development of capitalism in Russia, in which he tries to argue that there was a social differentiation going on in the peasantry, and that you had the development of a kulak class, and it was exploiting the rural poor like a proletariat. I mean, all of that was based on a sort of snapshot sociology. In other words, he took the Zemstvo local assembly statistics of agronomy, land use in an area, but it was a snapshot at one moment. And what the importance of Chayanov was for understanding the peasantry, and it was really, it was at the root of my work on the peasantry, was that actually the peasant economy is a cycle. It's a biological cycle. The size of the household, as the Russian family is a three-generation stem family, grandparents, working couple, children, and then the problem of what you do with the daughter-in-law and all that stuff. But I mean, basically, it's a vertical family structure. And it, as the number of children grows, and the amount of land that the peasant household gets increases as a result, because the commune is there to give more land to bigger households, mm-hmm. you have a life cycle of the peasant family which is running in parallel to the what in fact is a dynamic process, mm-hmm. which is not social differentiation at all. And that idea was really at the heart of my understanding of the peasantry in the revolution and the Civil War. And what I ended up doing in this book was not to write about the peasant uprisings, but to look in detail at the at village politics, what was happening at the village level during the revolution and Civil War. And I felt that the Chayanovian way of looking at the peasantry was borne out by the politics, mm-hmm. because the Bolsheviks went to the countryside, with guns to get food and soldiers, and they thought that they were exploiting a situation of class conflict. So they tried to set the poor peasants against the rich peasants. But the villagers didn't see themselves that way at all. Mm-hmm. They said, well, what are you talking about? We're all poor, you know? Mm-hmm. So fundamentally, I think showing in history, through history, that this idea of the mass of the population, mm-hmm. after all, mm-hmm. didn't match the reality, and therefore that was part of the problem of Soviet power, really. Mm-hmm. That the people in power were applying the wrong understanding of the majority of the people. But it was hard, and it was based on a lot of archival work, which is why it took 3 years. And this was a time when the archives were only just beginning to open up. I think I was the first historian of the revolutionary period to have any access to the catalogues. I mean, imagine, you give them permission to work in an archive, but you're kept in a separate room, which is minded by the KGB. You can only apply for those files whose numbers and contents you know the existence of. You can only know the existence of those files through the footnotes of other historians. If they've been published by Soviet historians, then the archivist is okay with giving it to you. That's how the control system works, yeah? Mm-hmm. So you don't have access to the catalogues. How do you work? You look for footnotes and then hope for the best. But I found a flaw in the system, because the system was based on keeping Westerners segregated from the Soviets. So we weren't allowed to go into the canteen. There was a group of us, you know, working in the archive as foreigners, various subjects. So we tried eating in the beer factory next door, and that worked for a few months. But then they said, hang on a minute, you don't look like beer factory workers, so we had to clear out of there. the one thing that they hadn't segregated us over was the toilet. There was only one toilet, and the toilet was the place where you went to smoke. And so I used to hang out at a certain time in the toilets, and my Marlboro cigarettes would be traded around the historians and the archivists. And I befriended one particular archivist who gave me the numbers I needed. Mm-hmm. That's how it worked.
And I have read that you even got friends with some librarians, and you even dated a librarian.
Oh dear.
But this is too private, but you have written it.
You promised you wouldn't embarrass me.
But I go something more serious.
It is a serious point. I've always said to my PhD students going to Russia, or indeed, I would say to any student, are there any students in the room? I can see some people who might be students here. My number one rule of guidance for students going into archives is your best friend is the archivist.
Of course, yes.
Because the archives are organized by archivists. They're not organized for you as a student. Mm-hmm. Then the archives are there for archival purposes, not for research purposes. So you need the archivist to take you seriously. Mm-hmm. So even if there's nothing, I mean, on my desk there'd be nothing to read often. You know, they would. Mm-hmm. If you had one file, you just hung on to it. You pretended mm-hmm. to be closely studying this one file. It could be something miserable like milk delivery quotas from a collective farm. I mean, what use can that be? But you spend hours looking at it. To convince them you're serious. But then the other thing is you've got to remember that all the jobs in these libraries and archives are actually run, they're actually young women. And although they've been trained, in our case, by the KGB to look after us, although they're extremely conventional and careful and everything else you'd expect of them, they're still human beings. So you can get away with just a little bit of, you know, the slight smile, the twinkle in the eye, you know, it's not outright flirtation, but it is, you know, just sort of a human, sort of slight subtext going on that softens them a bit.
There is a subspecies very important here in Spain, we know very well, which is the priests thus archivists. This is also very important.
I have no idea how you
good,
get around
good
the priest.
Yes, good for you. No, but the point I wanted to raise before is that I wanted to ask you if you identify with this expression coined by E.P. Thompson, who is a historian admired by you, if I'm not wrong, the history from below, because I think that all the work, all your scholarly work, shows that you are really doing history from below. You are not interested in, you know, this expression by Lucien Febvre, histoire de masse et non de vedette. So since the beginning, you are not interested in the big leaders of the Russian Revolution, but in the peasants, in the peasantry. And this goes on through all your work, I think. Well,
yeah, I mean, you know, going through Cambridge was you couldn't but end up as a Thompsonian social historian, essentially. Because the Cambridge I went through as an undergraduate between 1917 and 1979 and 1982 was at the pinnacle of a historical renaissance in England, which had started with the social histories of the 1860s, the Age of Thompson, and all the others who did various types of social history, going back into, you know, all basically analysts, so all basically derivatives of the Anglo allies of the Annales school, and that's how we were taught. So there was no, in the Cambridge school, there was no division between social and political or social and economic. So that was always how I saw politics, that and I guess at that stage, historically, it felt very reactionary to look at elites still. You know, there were people, if you think about how they were teaching 19th century British history, for example, I mean, there were people you know, who did study, you know, John Vincent, who the historian of the liberal movement in Britain in the 19th century, he was interested in elites. But I mean, essentially, it was history in Britain in the 70s and 80s was very much history from, but it was really rooted in social history. And I think that empirical root, which is deeply ingrained in the way I've done history, so that I've not really taken a linguistic turn ever. I don't take much interest in Foucault. I have engaged with Foucault, but I don't find it a revealing way to talk about what interests me, which is, I suppose, you know, power, why things happen. I'm a historian of the real world out there. If I have a regret at the end of my career as a teaching historian, as an academic historian, because I've recently retired from academia, it is that history has, the academic discipline of history has moved away from the real world. It's moved into the sphere of you know, deconstruction studies, post-colonial studies, linguistic studies.
Gender studies.
I'm not going to knock gender studies, but it's not the subject matter. It's the fact that, you know, actually no one's looking at, say, class anymore. Mm-hmm. I think there will be a return to questions about class because the world's heading for one almighty class conflict. Mm-hmm. You know, it's historians have sort of, so that by the end of my teaching career, I felt at Birkbeck I was a little bit of a dinosaur.
Your breakthrough book was this one, A People's Tragedy. I think it's very significant that the word people is also in the title. So it's, again, the same story. And I want to quote from the book. You wrote, "The village was a hotbed of intrigue, vendettas, greed, dishonesty, meanness, and sometimes gruesome acts of violence by one peasant neighbor against another. It was not the haven of communal harmony that intellectuals from the city imagined it to be. It was simply that the individual interests of the peasants were often best served by collective activity." So that means that even if you were mostly interested in the peasantry, as you showed in your PhD and your first book, you were not idealizing that world at all, that you were really aware of what was going on into small villages.
I mean, I didn't want to spend my life studying peasants. I mean, I think it was a good place to start, but I think, there's bigger questions that the peasants relate to.
Of course. In the middle Volga.
And I saw myself as a historian of the revolution. So the concept of that book was to, it was an incredibly foolish, ambitious thing to do in a way. I'm not surprised now that some people thought it was almost arrogant to try to do this. And it certainly earned me a lot of enemies, but it wasn't meant as anything but an attempt to do something which I wanted to do and prove quite successful. Mm-hmm. But it was, I suppose applying, I think in that book, I'd started from the assumption that I wanted to bring into the history of the revolution the perspective I'd developed by studying the peasantry as a social historian and relating that to the broader world. But of course, I was eager to sort of do a book, I suppose a little bit like Simon Sharma's Citizens, which had just come out and I'd been, awe-inspired by. Who wouldn't be? It was a great bravura performance, and I thought, yeah, I could do that for Russia. Mm-hmm. So I had a go, and that was the result. It was the book that introduced me, or opened the door for me to a different way of writing history. Narrative history could be dramatic. You could have characters. You could have scenes that you could recreate with a sort of cinematic detail. You could take your readers to a place, give them the feel. And you have to do that to make a history move. You have to be able to put them on the streets of Petrograd, February 24, 1917. In three sentences. Mm-hmm. They have to be there, right? Mm-hmm. So all of that, as someone who, I've always enjoyed the writing. My mother was a fictional writer. I get great pleasure out of writing. Okay. I want to make history a literary craft. And the book was, that was my first attempt mm-hmm. at it.
One of the major theses, if I may use this word, in this book is that you maintain that all the basic elements of the Stalinist regime were all in place by the time Lenin died in 1924.
Yeah.
So that it was not something invented later. So that Lenin was not the kind of...
No.
It was something different.
And most of what Stalin did, actually, he did under Lenin anyway. He'd already tried it out, shall we say. The way the Stalin system worked, the more you look into it, Stalin was doing it in the Civil War already. The brutal terror and the coercive means of getting things done, the wielding of the stick whenever, the paranoid denunciations of traitors everywhere, even in his own ranks of revolutionaries. It was all there in the Civil War. And that was something Lenin encouraged.
Yeah, and we even wrote, the ultimate aim of the communist system was the transformation of human nature. So they wanted to go as far as that.
Yeah, and I guess that was my turning towards what was to become my next book. Maybe you've even got a slide of it, Natasha's Dance, because I'd always had my original interest in Russia was the arts. When I was a teenager, I was reading Russian literature. So I'd always had this fascination about Russian culture. And then having sort of somehow accidentally turned into a historian of Russia, it was the work I did at the end of A People's Tragedy, looking at the interface between the revolution and the arts, that made me think, I'd like to explore that area and take it back to look at, what makes Russia culturally hang together, if it does.
A much less known book is this one, Interpreting the Russian Revolution, which you co-authored with Boris Kolonitsky.
Yeah.
We cannot speak too long about anybody, about all the books, but I will read something from the very beginning, because you use the language understood as, and I quote from the beginning of the book, songs and texts, symbolic flags and emblems, pictures and monuments, banners and slogans, yeah. common speech and rumor, dress and body language, ritualized demonstrations by the crowd, parades and other ceremonies. So you look at the whole canvas just to try to interpret all the meanings.
Yeah, I mean, Boris and I were good friends. We'd met in the 90s, and I wanted to help him get published in the English language, I think. Mm-hmm. And some of our work dovetailed quite nicely. So, yeah, it was a way of getting his work into English and having, you know, an interchange about things that drew us together over 1917. And we were both at that time interested in the cultural turn, the linguistic turn mm-hmm. in historical studies. And we thought that there was something to be teased out of the politics of 1917. Mm-hmm. And it's a small academic book of essays, really, but it's got many of the ideas that came out of my collaboration with Boris. Yeah.
And the tragic hero of this book is Alexander Kerensky.
Well, that's much more Boris's
subject. The minister-president of the short-lived Russian Republic.
That's much more Boris's subject. He's written a wonderful biography recently of Kerensky. Yeah.
Who was quite a character.
He certainly was, yeah. I mean, he's easy to make fun of, but I couldn't resist in a people's tragedy, yeah.
Then comes Natasha's Dance.
Indeed.
I have to say that, in my opinion, and in many others, I am sure, the title is a stroke of genius. Maybe I have to explain very briefly for the people who don't know. The title comes from Tolstoy's War and Peace, where one of the main characters, the Countess Natasha Rostov, who is an aristocrat,
Indeed.
Then she visits the person of the family
uncle.
They call the uncle.
Yeah.
And then they play some folk song.
Yeah, they get out. I mean, the uncle has a serf wife and sort of spends a lot of time in some sort of woodland hut with her, and he has his balalaika. So it's, I suppose, how Tolstoy would like to imagine himself living in a way. And after a day's hunting, Natasha turns up with her brother Nikolai to sort of take refuge in this house, and the balalaika is brought out, and this serf sings, and then Natasha herself, you know, a countess who would never dance anything but the waltz and the polka, without any lesson or instruction, manages in Tolstoy's imagining to dance the pliaska, which is a Russian dance, perfectly. And he asks, you know, where does this, how could it be that she could do this? You see, so this is the idea, is there something, I guess, you know, to put it very crudely, is there a Russian soul? But I think Tolstoy was really asking, is there a Russian sensibility? I think, is there, what is there that makes us Russians and binds us, the aristocracy, with the common people, the peasants? Which was a subject of great anxiety and concern to him. It probably dominates Tolstoy's life, that question.
Yeah, but in that title is, in a nutshell, the main point of your book, which is the contrast between European, Western
Absolutely.
European culture and Russian culture, because this scene with Natasha shows that she's talking probably in French in St. Petersburg, but then she goes to a small village and there is the
Russian
sound
is
there.
She has a heart. Yeah, this is, so it's a romantic idea, but it's worth running with, because even if there isn't a common sense, but even if it is all myth, then actually that myth has played an important role. Mm-hmm. Because for one, it inspired writers like Tolstoy and Dostoevsky, and music which, you know, followed some idea of Russianness in sound. Mm-hmm. And it certainly influenced the visual arts. So, you know, this mythology of what it is to be Russian, what binds us as a nation, which is a subject that dominates so much of Russian literature in the 19th and 20th centuries, you know, it was a good metaphor for what the subject was about, certainly given that this dance, this encounter between the countess and the peasant, is you know, what the book is about, because it's about, you know, it covers the period from Peter the Great and the Europeanization of Russia in the 18th century, but asked, many people in Russia, Slavophiles and others, became concerned that Russia was losing its national character by emulating the West. So, you know, what and this subject, you know, is the old debate essentially between the Westernizers and the Slavophiles. I mean, it's still going on now. I mean, it's just that Putin is an extreme Slavophile, and he's winning the argument. But the argument's been had for many years, and the book doesn't sort of confront the argument. You know, that's rather boring to go through all the philosophy of this and that. But it's about how that ambiguous, paradoxical compound, which is Russia, a European civilization grafted onto a peasant culture, a folk culture, which is then reinvented through the prism of Western culture. So folk music is elevated into classical music. The vernacular language of the peasants through poets like Nekrasov and even Tolstoy to some extent is being assimilated into the literary language. So, I mean, going back to War and Peace, that's actually a really interesting dimension of that great novel, because, I mean, you have to read it in Russian to realize that the true hero of the novel is the Russian language. Because the book has about 3% of it in French, but it's mainly at the beginning of the novel. And as Russia goes through its watershed moment of 1812 and discovers itself in the battle against Napoleon, much as, I guess, Ukraine is discovering itself in its battle against Russia, it Russified itself. And the national consciousness, the national identity became stronger, and it was the remit of the artists of the 19th century to give expression to that. And running through War and Peace, what happens is that slowly, it's not just the characters that are Russifying themselves. So, you know, all the aristocrats, instead of drinking champagne, they start drinking Russian kvass. The Countess Helene in it, Princess Helene, sorry, at her salon where French has always been basically spoken, she says now, out of patriotic pride, that Russian must be spoken only, and there would be a forfeit to be paid by anyone who's used any French words. The trouble is they can't find a Russian word for forfeiture. So this, in a sense, is an element of this ambiguous compound.
And also here in Natasha's dance, there are certain individuals who are going through the book, like, of course, Tolstoy, but also Ilya Repin, Anna Akhmatova, Marina Tsvetaeva.
Sure.
So people who are going through the whole story.
Sure, because you can't tell... You know, you can't do a cultural history, which is what Natasha's dance is. You can't do a cultural history without the people who make it. I mean, you've got to allow for the subjective factor, if I can put it that way. You've got to allow for the fact that there are just some artistic geniuses. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, yeah, Akhmatova comes along and she manages to speak for the whole Soviet people suffering under Stalin's yoke in 1937. You know, and that is what great art does. That's what makes great art powerful. That's what makes her a great poet. But you know, it's her biography that makes her the great poet as well. And it's the times she lived through, the agony she went through, the loss of her husband, the loss of her son, her virtual house arrest under Stalin, her vilification by the whole system, the loss of friends punished because they had met her. All of this, you know, this is the tragedy of the great artist in that context. So that is, yeah, part of the story. You can't write a cultural history by telling a sort of series of sort of analytical essays about isms. I don't give a damn about isms. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in the artists, which is, you know, why, I mean, that's, you know, looking ahead, again, was my approach to cultural history in the Europeans. I didn't want to talk about the isms. I mean, all of the literature I consulted for that book, you know, the secondary literature, was hopeless for me because it was all written by literary scholars and sort of cultural historians of a sort who are interested in isms. And actually, I thought, no, this is not what I'm after the business of the art. I want to know what really preoccupied artists, because when I read the artists' letters, all they're interested in is how to make money. That's all they're interested in. They don't want to talk about their art. They just want to know what's the best and most efficient way to make money so that they have the most time for their art, right?
Yeah.
And if you ask any artist in the room, they'd probably say, yeah, that's all I'm interested in. but that wasn't how the cultural history of 19th century Europe was written.
Yeah.
It was a sequence of isms. But Natasha's dance was, you know, I felt the biographical element of that was absolutely crucial to animate it.
And I think that apart from the tension between Western culture and Russian soul, which is showed in this title, Natasha's Dance, as you have explained very well. You explain also something which is very important, which I think is the importance of culture in Russia and the moral authority of Russian artists and especially Russian writers. And you quote this line by Osip Mandelstam, saying, poetry is respected only in this country. There is no place where more people are killed for it. Which is tremendous, really.
And Stalin was a poet too. Teenage boy wrote Georgian poetry.
Yeah.
He knew that Mandelstam was a genius, mm-hmm. but he destroyed him.
But he died as he died. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Your next book, also a great success, is The Whisperers. We go again to history from below. And this is your first collaboration with the Memorial Society, which has been closed down last year, if I'm not wrong, by the court. So it's
correct.
Impossible to do the work.
You couldn't do that book now.
To do.
No.
And here you go really to the, you go deep into the life of
the dark depths.
Individual people to go to the subterranean currents.
Mm.
And of course, the title is again a stroke of genius. So. Something which can only be whispered, and even if it's whispered, it's dangerous. Because
yeah, but there's two types of whisperer in the Russian language. There's also shiptun, the other word for whisperer, which is an informer, someone who whispers to the police about the suspect. So it's a double-edged word.
And it's as it happens in most of the autocratic regimes, the spy can be your brother, your sister, your wife, your neighbor,
absolutely.
Anybody. And this is something that you are showing.
Yeah, so I thought that there was an opportunity with oral history, which again is another form of history from below, and that the literature on the Stalin phenomenon or experience or system or whatever you want to call it had not yet really brought out the voices of the repressed or the people who had lived through it, who could still talk about the internal life. I was very influenced by a Russian historian called Mikhail Gefter, and he had this great phrase in one of his essays, well, it's a discussion online, really, in which he said that, you know, the real power of Stalin was not the cult of Stalin, not the system of oppression, not the propaganda as such. The real power of Stalin was the Stalin inside of us. The Stalin we allowed into us and assimilated so that we behaved in the way that we did. Not that we necessarily need to blame ourselves, but we need to recognize that we are victims of our own crimes as a people. Mm-hmm. And so unlike other people, like say, you know, maybe the Ukrainians or maybe the deported peoples like the Chechens can all say we were victims of someone else, but the Russians can't say that. So I felt that the oral history that one could do by examining this internal world, what was the Stalin that entered into them, and how did it impact on their relationships, on their moral compass, really, because everyone had to make some moral compromises at the very least. And I felt that there was a lot of, you know, evidence that could be got out of that. So I started interviewing people. In fact, my interest in all to go went right back to my early days in Russia when I was working on that book, Peasant Russia, about the peasantry. Because then, we're talking about mid-1980s, I thought, oh, it might be quite good to see if I could find anyone still alive who remembered the Civil War period. I mean, it's not absolutely impossible. But I couldn't find anyone, certainly no one willing to talk to me through contacts. But the funny story about this is that I then went back to Cambridge, where, as you say, I had this research fellowship. And I had my first lunch at Trinity College, Cambridge, where I was a research fellow, so a young academic. And the system there was it's a bench, and you get your food, and you sit at the bench next to the next person. And then, so it's random. And the first person I sat down to at my first lunch at Trinity was this very old man called Hans Lissmann, a very dear man. And he asked in that way that the English have of small chat, I suppose, what are you working on? So I said, oh, I work on the Russian peasantry in the Civil War. And he said, oh, that's funny. I got to know much of the Russian peasantry in the Civil War because he was a Volga German origin, had been born in Nikolaev, now under Russian occupation, I think, and had been deported to the Siberia in the First World War as a German speaker, and then with his father had been allowed back by horse and cart towards Ukraine or wherever they felt they were going, and they'd got as far as the Volga when they sort of got bogged down in the Civil War, but put into a refugee camp where his father became head of provisions. Didn't know what calories were, but managed to work it out. And Hans, as a kid, his job was to trade with the peasants because everyone lived in the black market then. So he was taking out boxes of matches or kerosene or vodka or whatever and trade with the peasants for food. So he had all these pictures of all these peasants in the very region I was working. But anyway, that's a digression, yes. So I was a believer in oral history and I started on my own to begin with just through contacts. And found an explosion of interest. So, I mean, I started working with someone I just met through friends, and I said, would you do this for me with your little telegram, you know, ask them these sort of questions? And he went off and did it, and he came back and said, you know, Orlando, a lot of people are very interested in this. My friends would like to do some interviewing too. And I said, yeah. I said, how many friends have you found? And he said, 250. You know, so there was a sort of an outpouring of people wanting to talk about this. To someone sympathetic, not to me, but to another Russian who, you know, was going to go. But then I got this grant, and we went through Memorial, and we had a whole system of you know, a whole database of people, and went through a whole oral history project, which was expensive and complicated and highly stressful. And this was the product of it.
But the picture you get at the end when you read this book is that it was a completely traumatized society.
Yeah.
And that the after effects remained for long. So it's not only during the Stalinist time,
yeah,
but
I think that's the big lesson that we all learned. I mean, I made a radio program for the BBC about the project, and my memorial partners, you know, several of them said that was the big thing they had learned out of this project, because they'd not really thought about the internal aspects of Stalin before. They'd done projects of their own, but they'd been, you know, just getting the basic facts of where people had gone, trying to recover people's records. That was their remit. They hadn't sort of gone into the internal world. And I think they were also surprised by the degree to what many people talked about of, for example, genetic fear was a term. It's commonly used in Russia by these sort of people, that the sense that the inheritance of this shockwaves of fear has been to make everyone into whisperers in a way. And I think a lot of that explains the passivity. A lot of people say, why aren't the Russians protesting against this war? You know, are they all passive? It's not that they're passive. I mean, obviously, who would want to go out with a placard saying "Нет войне" or have nothing on the placard and be arrested and possibly face 15 years in a very harsh penal colony? You know, I mean, how many in this room would do that? I'm not sure many of us would. So let's not rush to judgment on the Russians. But there's certainly a broader context here, which goes back to exactly what we learned from the Whisperers, which is that this fear comes down So that, you know, if you think about, I mean, this war in a way is just the last in a whole series of waves of terror that have gone through that society, going back with greater waves of violence to 1937. And when a society over three or four generations goes through that, it's a post-traumatic society. I mean, you know, I'm in Spain. We, you know, you understand what a post-traumatic society is because you've had a civil war. And, you know, Russia's had several civil wars in that sense. So the regime just has to pick up the baton. Doesn't have to use it. Just has to pick up the baton, and people read the signals, and they...
That's enough. Mm-hmm. Then you changed quite a lot to your next book, The Crimean War, which is today more necessary than ever to know.
Yeah, that was an accident, wasn't it?
And in the British edition, as you can see probably from your place, it was subtitled The Last Crusade.
Indeed, the Americans didn't like that.
And you know that in Spanish, the subtitle was The First Great War.
Ah, okay.
So different subtitles for the
All
same
right.
book.
But you know, there's a certain amount of license, but the Spaniards are pretty good at it. The people who are really quite naughty with titles are the Italians. So I wrote a book whose title was Just Send Me Word, about a correspondence in and out of the gulag between a couple, two parts of a couple. And they sent Just Send Me Word into qualcosa di più dell'amore, something a bit more than love. which is operatic for sure, but it's not quite what I meant, but anyway.
I'm going to read something from this book. The Crimean War was also the earliest example of a truly modern war, fought with new industrial technologies, modern rifles, steamships and railways, novel forms of logistics and communication like the telegraph, important innovations in military medicine, and war reporters and photographers directly on the scene. Yet, at the same time, it was the last war to be conducted by the old codes of chivalry, with parliamentaries and truces in the fighting to clear the dead and wounded from the killing fields.
Yeah.
So nothing to do with what is going on today
yeah,
in the same
absolutely.
Area.
I mean, that book came out in 2010, and then in 2014, when it all kicked off, I thought I'd just written. Yeah, I mean, it was well received in Germany, this book, because they loved it. They loved it because it was the first big book about a modern war they could read that the Germans weren't the guilty partners in. But otherwise, yeah, I thought, okay, I'd written this military history. I'd enjoyed doing it. I thought it had said something important. But then suddenly, the Russians with their little green men invade Crimea. And I, you know, so you get, you know, this weird situation of Twitter had, I think, on the first day of the invasion, virtually, Crimean War trending, you know, Twitter trending for the first time since 1854, you know. Suddenly I was called upon by the world's press to say, what, you know, where is the Crimea? Why do the Russians care about it? Et cetera, et cetera. But yes, the parallels with today and what's going on are absolutely extraordinary. And it seems to me that Putin, you know, Putin has in his office, in that ridiculous room in the Kremlin, where he has that ridiculous long table. Again, it's an Italian table. He has four. There are four statues, I think they're the statues of the people he seems to, compare himself with. So there's Peter the Great, conquered, or in Putin's idea, reconquered Russian lands from the Baltic. There's Catherine the Great, who conquered what she called New Russia, which is what. Is now occupied by Russian forces in the south of Ukraine. Alexander I, who, he began the conquest of the Caucasus, but he also was the man who defeated Napoleon. So he's the greatest hero in a way because he fits the story of Russia that Putin wants to tell, that you need a strong state and a great leader to repel a hostile West. and save Europe from its people like Napoleon or Hitler. So, but the problem is that Nicholas went to war, you know, against the whole of the West for what he saw as orthodox interests, this greater, this Russian world, as Putin calls it, mm-hmm. and underestimated the ability of the Turks to fight back. Well, that sounds familiar. Mm-hmm. And underestimated the willingness of the West to intervene. He thought he had a sort of gentleman's agreement with the British, but turned out not. And they went in on the side of the Turks, which is a problem for the British because they were a Christian country, and punished the Russians and imposed the harshest peace on the Russians that had ever been imposed on a great power. I mean, it was part of the concert of Europe, the understanding that you don't humiliate a great power. And Russia was a great power, but they humiliated it. They treated it like they had treated China in the Opium Wars, that it didn't have, you know, so they demilitarized Russia. They destroyed Sevastopol, the naval base, and that created a great deal of resentment in Russia against the West, which still runs on today. So many of the sort of accusations of double standards by the West, the accusations of Russophobia against the West, all of this goes back to Nicholas I. But, you know, Putin is in danger of making the same mistakes, that he goes to war against the whole of the West and he gets badly beaten.
In the story of Russia, we will get to your latest book very soon, you quote a Tsarist censor in his diary, 1855, Alexander Nikitenko, and he wrote about the Crimean War, God, so many victims.
Yeah.
About 750,000 soldiers were killed in the Crimean War and endless civilians.
Yeah.
And 2/3 were Russian.
Yeah.
So, my God, so many victims, all at the behest of a mad will drunk with absolute power. We have been waging a war not for 2 years, but for 30, maintaining an army of 1 million men and constantly threatening Europe. What was the point of it all?
could ask exactly the same question in exactly the same words today. I mean, what is the point of this war?
Yeah.
You know, whatever twisted historical mythology Putin believes or just uses because he thinks it's in his interest to use it, for what? Why go killing all these people? For what? You know, it's incredible. And, you know, when this is the only one of my books to be published in Russia. So, there were attempts before. I mean, when the People's Tragedy came out, my college, Trinity, being very rich, gave a grant to a Russian publisher to translate my book and publish it. But the Russian publisher turned out to be like many publishers in Russia in the 1990s. It was, you know, a fly-by-night operation, as we say. And they ran off with the money and didn't publish the book. And the Whispers was meant to be in Russian, but, you know, a whole number of things got in the way, which I don't want to rehearse because it's a long story in itself. But the Crimea, which I see as quite a sort of almost pro-Russian book, really, because I do think there was a lot of Russophobia in the 19th century. And I do think that the West treated Russia with double standards. I mean, I think Nicholas I was mad, but, you know, I mean, that's part of the story. But overall, I felt that in giving the Russian, I mean, there hadn't been a history of the Crimean War since Tarle, who was Stalin's favorite historian. And it was just pure Russian imperial historiography. So Crimean War, you know, was one of those untouchable subjects because, you know, I mean, and that's, again, looking forward to the story of Russia, I mean, that's, you know, a point I wanted to make very early on, that part of the reason why history is so mythologized in Russia is it really does serve a very strong political purpose for Russia's rulers. It's really the political discourse of governance in Russia in a way that we probably don't understand in the West. So, you know, and the Crimean War is absolutely crucial to the story that Putin tells about Russia. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I'm in my long-winded way going on and on. The point I wanted to make is that my Russian publisher, you know, bravely published this book only 2 years ago, mm-hmm. bravely published this book by putting on the cover that exact quotation.
Oh, God. Now comes a very easy quiz, I hope, for you. I'm going to read something. Perhaps only love and war can raise the temperature of life sufficiently to give real life an interest to letters written by lost generations. And the vicissitudes of war have more infinite variety than even the most consuming passion. Do you know who wrote this?
Vicissitudes of war? No, I'm sorry, I was looking at the spec.
That's your mother.
Right? Ah, my dear mother, yes.
That's your dear mother. Eva Feiges,
yeah.
Or Eva Ungar, because she was born in Berlin. And this
Right.
is part of the prologue of this women's letter in wartime.
Yeah.
This, of course, is the introduction to your piece.
Connection. No, I'd never thought of that connection.
Because I thought that your mother edited this book about letters written by women in wartime. And your book is not exactly about wartime, but it's almost
It is a war in a way,
as
isn't
if,
it?
Because a person in the gulag is almost
it's
like
being
in
it's an extraordinary story.
War.
I mean, it really is. I mean, it's a mind-boggling story that this cache of letters was presented to me by the Memorial Society from this couple who had been separated for... how many years was it? Eight years. 8 years, with Lev being in the Pechora Arctic labor camp, and Svetlana, his sweetheart. They weren't married, but they, you know, been separated first by the war, and then he'd been arrested and sent north in the filtration of Soviet soldiers coming back from Allied occupied territories, and he. He spent 8 years, but they somehow managed to work out a system of smuggling the letters in and out of the labor camp, which I worked out through, again, oral history. I met the couple, asked them questions, and I met people from the camp, began to work with the archive of the camp to try and understand how this world worked.
More than 1,200 letters.
A lot of letters.
Not, yes.
So although they were open to self-censorship, they weren't, to a certain extent, inevitably so, I guess. They were much more honest and frank, albeit with sometimes Aesopian, having to convey the meaning between the lines. But they were of a different quality of correspondence from any official correspondence, because anyone who wrote officially to the camp, you know, it would be read by the censors and they would black out or destroy letters and stuff. So so this is, in a way, it was, I thought, just a stunning document, because these letters are, you know, as far as we knew until that point, I still think they are the first and only real-time, large-scale documentary base of evidence about what it was like to live in the gulag. Mm-hmm.
And in the end, you managed to meet them personally.
Just before Lev died. I did. Just before Lev died, we went out there with a... We were trying to get a film together for the BBC about it, and it never got made. But we did the filming for the delivery of it. And I have those tapes. And it was very touching. I mean, they were very, very elderly and frail. But sweet people, really amazing elderly people. It was such a privilege to meet them. And we did some interviews with Lev that were actually quite useful. Mm-hmm.
It was a sort of happy end after all the
I think it
immense
was a happy
suffering.
End. And it wasn't. I mean, the Italian title, Romantic, though, is. I can understand why they went for it, because this relationship really was spiritual. I mean, in the sense that she's, you know, to support a man through the gulag, in her position, where she's, you know, a party member, a Komsomol member, working in a research institute, which is military. If her friends or employers knew, or too many, you know, people knew that she was writing secret letters to Lev in the camp, and if they knew, in fact, that she, on three occasions, astonishingly, broke into the camp to visit him, going incognito to a forbidden zone and smuggling herself into a camp to spend a night with him. I mean, you know, she would go to a camp herself if this was known.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, to do that is something, it is something. I mean, that's more than love, isn't it? That's something, something special.
Then you went back to revolutionary Russia through the history of three generations, more or less the old Bolsheviks, the people who came of age during the beginning of the Stalinist regime, and then what you call the 60s, I mean, the people of Gorbachev generation.
Yeah. I mean, really, that's a... Really, that's, I mean, that was published as a Pelican book, because Penguin, when he grew up in my generation, there was this publishing thing that we all had of penguins and pelicans. And pelicans were the non-fiction, slightly progressive version of penguins, which were fiction. And they wanted to relaunch it, and so they invited me to be one of the six new titles. And I chose this for it, because in a way it was a pedagogic book, because I wanted... I was unhappy with the way Russian revolutionary history was taught in schools. And I felt that after the collapse of communism too, it was good to take a sort of longer arc for the revolution. I mean, when does the Russian revolution end? You know, I thought, well, why don't we look at it in the whole and say it ends in 1991? How would it look different? So again, I think this is my attempt to look for the continuities, which are probably rooted in my interest in deep social history, in deep political culture, because in Russia, those continuities are absolutely fundamental.
And the famine in the 1890s can also be interpreted as the beginning of the...
Yeah, I mean, that was just a trick, because a people's tragedy began in 1891 with what I saw as the moment in which the revolution begins, because society is politicized in a new way by a famine which the government is blamed for.
Mm-hmm. Then the Europeans, which is a magnificent book, dedicated to your sister Kate.
Yeah.
And this is also a stroke of genius to mix the lives of Louis Viardot, Pauline Viardot, who was a Spaniard. You know that last year in the anniversary, we had a series of concerts here with
chamber operas
and piano pieces and songs and everything.
Yeah. And a book important, I hope, for my Spanish readers, for you, I hope, that this was a book that took really... a family which are important culturally in Europe. Mm-hmm. And they're Spanish, albeit itinerant Spaniards, I suppose. But, you know, they introduce us to a part of European cultural history in which Spain is absolutely central and of central interest to people thinking about Europe. Mm-hmm. What is Europe? Where does it begin? Where does it end? Also interesting to those sort of people in a way that Russia is interesting to them. So this balance between, you know, the way Europe was conceived, Spain and Russia were both sort of in the 19th century or in the early 19th century, you know, when the Napoleonic generation, they discovered the Spaniards, and then because of the various revolutions in Spain and the Napoleonic period itself, you have a lot of Spaniards becoming French people. Like Aguado, one of the great heroes of 19th century opera. You'll know all about him, who you know, is little known about, but a tremendously interesting figure, this Spanish banker, lender to the governments of the world, who became one of the great patrons of the arts in the 19th century, a great friend, patron of, you know, so all of this world of was really interesting, and it was lovely to be able to counterbalance Spain and Russia through this trio of people, of Pauline Viardot, who was of Spanish descent, but, you know, raised in France in the Italian operatic tradition and, like, fluent in five languages, etc. And then her husband, who's this French radical republican, who's also a great Hispanist.
Translator of the Quixote.
Translator of Cervantes, exactly. So, and a great promoter of the Spanish masters in the European art world, and a great, you know, knowledgeable person about visual art in particular, very rude about the English. And then this Russian who enters their lives. So and their interest in Russia. So it was just a really beautiful way for me to sort of frame Europe and to tell the story of 19th century culture as the coming together of Europe, in a way, the creation of a pan-European culture. And I think sensibility in a way that, you know, existed before, but only for the elites, and because of capitalism, essentially. The arts go through the mill of capitalism in a way that enables them to become popular and to find a mass audience.
Of course, Pauline belonged to this Spanish family, Manuel García, where, as Liszt put it, genius seems to be hereditary.
Indeed.
Like in your family, your mother, your sister, yourself.
Genius is a big word.
I want to read something by Pauline, which is not in your book, but if you don't know it, you may like it. So Pauline was only once in Spain in 1842, when she was only 21, came back to Spain, never came back to Spain. And nearly 50 years later, in the 1890s, she wrote to the daughter-in-law of her friend, George Sand, Lina Sand.
Ah, yes, that letter, yeah, I do know.
And she wrote this incredible thing. I had never set foot there up until then, and yet, as soon as I crossed the frontier, it seemed to me that everything that I saw, I had seen it before. It seemed to me that everything that I heard, I had heard before. Every figure that I encountered seemed like a memory from a dream. I recognized everything. Nothing surprised me. Everything was familiar to me. I felt that this country was my real home.
How
it's
wonderful.
A piece of
it's
literature.
Wonderful. Yeah, it
so
is.
So Pauline was
but
a real...
It's also Natasha's dance, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a real miracle.
How can it be that a woman... Okay, she's brought up speaking Spanish, but and feels Spanish culture.
She was speaking Spanish to her siblings. I mean, to Maria Malibran and to Manuel Patricio García.
But, you know, I mean, it's a slightly romanticized vision, I would have thought, that you can feel all of that. I mean, obviously, she wanted to feel that, so maybe she did feel it.
Yeah.
Because you can, you know, bring on these feelings of warmth and recognition and familiarity with people you want to be brothers of, in my case, so or brothers and sisters of, shall we say. So, it's wonderful, yeah.
I think this painting also shows what you tell in the Europeans. So this
Well, the cult of Beethoven, the statue is Beethoven, I mean...
So the bust of Beethoven, Liszt playing the piano, Gagoul, Dima, Victor Hugo, George Sand, Paganini, Rossini, Lord Byron portrayed in the wall, so it's amazing.
I mean, there's a great book to be written about that painting. I mean, not the painting itself as such, but the subject matter, which you will know as a musicologist, which is, what the hell do you do after Beethoven? You know, I mean, that's the problem of, I mean, and it's true in I guess, a lot of areas of art. I mean, it's true in an area of music that I take a great interest in, which is jazz. I mean, what do you do after Miles Davis if you're a trumpet player? What do you do after John Coltrane if you play the tenor? I mean, there's nowhere to go after that.
There are two scores on the piano, on the Konrad Graf piano. The one on the right is the funeral march of the Eroica.
Sorry, I keep interrupting you. I'm very rude.
No, it's okay. So the score on the right is the funeral march. The score on the left is a Fantasia by Liszt himself.
Yeah.
One of the many things you tell in this wonderful story of the Europeans is the importance of the development of lithographic printing, the importance of railways, and the importance of photography. For instance, Louis Viardot was one of the persons using photographic reproduction in his art.
All of those are absolutely crucial to the dissemination, particularly, obviously, of the visual arts.
And the railway was also crucial for the building of nations.
Absolutely.
And also for the growing nationalism.
But also in terms of the art and the way the business worked, it was important for the development of a canon, because in the days of coach and horses, like thinking of Rossini's days, you know, you could only fill an audience about this, we would fill the theatres of the early 19th century. And so you have a small catchment area, but once you have the railways, you can build bigger theatres because you can fill them with suburban audiences, or people coming, staying in the hotels by the railway station, going to the opera, doing the whole whole city thing, and that meant that you could have a more stable repertoire, because you didn't have to keep changing it for a small audience. You could have long runs of, you know, Faust, Gounod's Faust, I think, had 500 runs at the Paris, 500, you know, a run, a season of 500 performances. 500 performances of the same opera in one opera house. I mean, that's just, you know, it was unheard of. So, I mean, if you look at the repertoire of operas in, you know, the days of Spontini and all of these people in the late 18th century, I mean, they had a run of one. Sometimes one cut in half. So this is a transformation of the arts. But the other thing about, and this gets back to the question of money, the other technology or element of 19th century culture, which I see as the third of these three, of these pillars that you've mapped out, yes, the railways, yes, lithography and mass printing, but it's copyright. Copyright is the...
The Berne prize, Convention.
I won a prize here this last year from the foundation of copyright law that you have here wonderfully in Madrid. But people don't write about copyright except legal historians, really. But I was really interested in copyright because if you, as I said before, if you read the diaries and certainly the letters of artists, they're not interested in these isms. It's like they're complaining about their publishers ripping them off or something. Yeah. So, and, you know, Flaubert, who's my great hero, I have, you probably don't know this, but I have actually written a play which is going to be produced.
Wait.
Ah, okay, so, sorry. But Flaubert, poor Flaubert, he, you know, Madame Bovary, you know, he should have made a fortune out of that book, especially after being put through the courts for obscenity. But, you know, he got paid one-off fee. So copyright was terribly important because once artists had a way to make income off their copyright, the artistic product itself becomes a form of capital, which you share with the publisher. Whether it's the score in music or the book and the copyright on that or the copyright on lithographic reprints of pictures. So that's, sorry, well, how do we get onto copyright?
But Russia didn't sign the Berne Convention.
No, and that's actually part of the reason why in the late 1880s there was this boom in interest in Russian literature. That's why they discovered Russian literature. You know, until that point, you know, Turgenev was the most read Russian writer, but suddenly they discovered the octane-powered Russian literature of Dostoevsky and Tolstoy. Mm-hmm. And they think, ooh, yes, this is the real thing. Let's get this because it's sort of big and what they want out of Russia, like they want out of Russian music, a certain exotica. They found that in Russian literature. But the reason why publishers were prepared to pay for the translation of Russian literature into French, usually, was that they didn't have to pay the Russians any copyright.
And Turgenev was also very important in making
things translated. He was one of these great intermediaries. I mean, again, you know, this is exactly why to write cultural history, you need to write about artists, you need to write about individuals, because what all of these three have in common is that they're all great internationalists, cosmopolitans, who helped the arts cross boundaries. Because they were interested in promoting friends and people whose work they liked. So Turgenev was fantastic in getting Russian artists and writers and musicians known in Europe. And, you know, some of Zola's novels were published in Russia before they were published in France.
I was saying that this is a famous photograph of Pauline Viardot in her old age, more or less when she wrote what I quoted before. Now we are moving just for a while to music, which, you know, is one of my main interests. This is a quotation from the entry on nationalism by Richard Taraskin in the New Growth Dictionary of Music and Musicians. Nationalism should not be equated with the possession or display of distinguishing national characteristics, or not, at any rate, until certain questions are asked and at least provisionally answered. The most important ones are, first, who is doing the distinguishing, and second, to what end? I'm quoting this because I had the privilege of interviewing Richard Taraskin during the lockdown in the summer of 2020.
Lucky you.
And it was She was in California, and I was here. But even so,
it was fantastic. A privilege,
and the interview was published in El País. It was a long one. And after quoting this, I asked him, nationalisms are back ever more strongly, and political leaders like Trump, I'm talking summer 2020, Putin, Bolsonaro, some of them are gone now, Johnson, also gone, Orban, e tutti quanti, are becoming an increasing threat for the rest of the world. Why now? And Taraskin's reply, because it's always there, along with its cousin racism, and always exploitable when politicians need to distract their populations from the problems their greed is causing. The world order post-1945 hid it for a while behind international treaties in the West and the internationalist facade of communism in the East. But as soon as the latter fell, Yugoslavia erupted, and well, you remember. I guess you agree on this.
I agree on the, yeah, I don't agree with some of the implications I sort of hear there, but I certainly agree with the general concept for sure. But I'm not sure that I sort of share, I mean, when people invoke Yugoslavia, they usually, and preface it by saying it was always there, they tend to have this model that nationalism is always seething away in society, and that once you lift the lid on it, it's going to explode, like, you know, reflux. So I'm not sure that I buy into that model entirely. Because I think that for nationalism to explode in the way that it did in the Yugoslav wars, particularly in the Serbian form, and the nationalism we're seeing now in Putin's war, is not a nationalism which sits naturally in people. It would be an exaggeration to say that the Soviet Union was a sort of seething pit of inter-ethnic hatreds. I mean, it was in the Caucasus, but it's always been a seething pit of inter-ethnic hatreds in the Caucasus. I mean, that's really true. But, you know, so I'm not sure that it seems to me that the poisonous, aggressive, violent nationalism that is being weaponized by the Russians against Ukraine is something that has to be brewed. If I can continue with the reflux metaphor, the yeast in that brewing process for Putin is history, it's mythology,
falsification of history.
It's not the falsification of history. I mean, because in that now infamous article of July 2021 on the historical unity of Russians and Ukrainians, which Putin spent a long time writing and researching, and which can now be read as a declaration of his war, because he denied the national existence of Ukraine or the right of Ukraine to exist as an independent nation. In that article, there's nothing factually wrong. It's just that it's mad. The interpretation is mad. I mean, it's mad because what is the relevance of all of this to now? Nothing at all. But it's coming back to my slight difference with, say, Taruskin and how you would interpret nationalism as a belligerent force, is that his story of Russia, and this is what I'm trying to get at in my new book, is it may be a mythologization, perhaps rather than falsification of history, or you could say it's a falsification in a loose sense. But it's that it's a use of history that, to some extent, is based on 19th century imperial historiography. So what he's saying is what Russians have been taught in schools for a very long time, that Russia grew, colonized itself, collected the Russian lands, including Ukraine and Russia, Ukraine and Belarus, as part of its natural organic growth. So that it is essentially a greater civilizational empire. Putin argues that in a way that's influenced by all sorts of, you know, rather ugly ideologies from the 20th century, but the core of it is imperial historiography. But what Putin has done in his very tight control of history over the last 15 years is to impose on the generation that has come through an imperial view of history, which is again built on the Soviet version of history, that is basically the story, you know, of Alexander Nevsky. It's the same story told time and time again, that Russia is a big, open, large-hearted, kind-hearted, multicultural, multinational federation nation, or empire, really. But and that, you know, the Ukrainians are part of us. That's how the Russians have always been taught. It's how Karamzin and the other 19th century historians who shaped the basis of Russian historiography thought about Russia, or Great Russia and Ukraine, or Little Russia, as they called it in this discourse. And that's very much what you know, Putin is playing on, and that imperial historiography, that you know, the Russians are superior to the Ukrainians. So this is fundamentally an imperial war. It's fundamentally about Russia as the civilizational imperial state leader beating this colony who had the cheek to try to break away. But the story that he imposes into that through that essay of July 2021 is feeding on this story that goes back to Alexander Nevsky, that Russia is a peaceful society, but it's attacked by a powerful West. And the West, because it's always hates Russia, will use any enemy it can against Russia. And so there's this long history of the West using Ukraine and Ukrainian nationalism to try and destroy Russia. In the story of Alexander Nevsky, it's the Teutonic Knights and the Germans, but you need a strong state leader to repel them. You need, Alexander I does it against the Napoleonic forces. You know, so this is the story that the Russians have been told. And it then goes through the whole Soviet historiography of we're the only socialist state and we're attacked by all these hostile powers. It feeds into the whole consciousness which most adult, you know, Russians have grown up with in one form or another, or inherited from their parents and their schooling, which is the Cold War. The West is the enemy. So all of this mythologization of history that we see in Putin, I mean, the point is that we need to understand where all that's coming from. The point is, we need to understand why that has traction among many Russians. Why many Russians support the idea of leaving it up to their leaders to decide what's necessary for them. Again, you know, we need to understand that against the backdrop, in the context of this genetic fear that we're talking about from the Stalin period. You know, so the West, if it's going to deal with Russia, and it's going to be dealing with it, unfortunately, for some time to come, really needs to understand the Russian worldview. Not to justify it, but just to understand why they feel so strongly about the things that the regime feels strongly about, and which the regime is able to get a significant proportion of the population. I can't tell you what proportion. I think increasingly Russians have at least discomfort about this war, because they're now beginning to see that it really is a war and that they're going to be involved in it. And why are they fighting in Ukraine and killing Ukrainians? So, you know, there's a discomfort about it, but there's also a significant proportion of the population which, you know, it makes sense to them what Putin's saying in terms of Russia and the West. Not because they're necessarily knowledgeable about history, but because they've had these stories since they were born. but also because a lot of them feel, a lot of them don't like the West because of the Cold War, but also because of their experiences since 1991. A lot of people really lost out from the crash, as they would see it, of 1991. And they, you know, they lost jobs, housing, security, pensions, savings, you know, and saw their country in their eyes ruined by criminality and corruption and humiliated in the eyes of the world. And they didn't adapt for one reason or another to the market system because they were fish out of water. I mean, it's not easy when you've lived in the Soviet Union all your life suddenly to, you know, catch up with a monetary economy, a free market. These are very difficult to adjust to quickly. So that sense of at least alienation, if not a resentment of the West, is you know, makes Putin's message very potent. And I'm afraid that it's a potent message for a lot of societies who feel resentment of the West. So Middle Eastern societies, Iran, China, India, Latin American countries, countries that have experienced colonialism. You know, there's a lot of places with grievances against the West. And as the pressures of globalization become more and more, you know, unfair, as many of these societies see for them, or for, you know, these are on the whole authoritarian regimes with stark contrast between rich and poor. So that when I said the world is heading for a massive class conflict, this is exactly what I mean. You know, I mean, we are in a situation because of the climate crisis and because of the economic crisis exacerbated by this war, we are in a situation where a lot of people are going to be destitute and a lot of people are going to die because climate crisis is going to make their societies no longer tenable economically. So there will be, you know, I don't want to get too dark, heaven's sake, it's Friday evening, and we all want to go to Madrid's wonderful restaurants. I'm hoping to get to one myself. But, you know, it's, we have to wake up to the fact that this anti-Western nationalism, you know, does have ideological traction. So it's not just, as Taruskin would say, a seething pit of hatreds that always is there and always will. It has to be engineered by the abuse of history in Russia's case.
There is a threat connecting Taruskin, you, and me, very modest one, is that the three of us wrote a review of this novel by Julian Barnes.
Very interesting.
I published my review in mid-May 2016, you published your own in the New York Review of Books the week after, and Taruskin in August. So I couldn't copy you. I couldn't copy you, but
did we agree?
We agreed, all of the three of us, on the weak points, and we disagree on the strong points. But basically, we say more or less the same things. I love one sentence in your review: "As a novel reader, I am willing to believe him. As a historian, I am not." You mean Shostakovich's voice recreated by Julian Barnes. We are having here, on this very stage, a concert cycle devoted to Shostakovich in March next year, called Dmitri Shostakovich and Soviet Censorship. And my question, and we have to now go quick until the very end, is shall we ever know the truth about what Shostakovich thought and what Shostakovich did? Because in my review, I compared, I don't know if it was fair or not, but I compared how Shostakovich and how Osip Mandelstam died, just to put in focus their positions in the regime.
Yeah, very good. I wish I'd done that in my review. yeah, for sure. I mean, Shostakovich dies a natural death, which is...
In hospital,
which is, yeah,
surrounded
it says
by honours.
Does that make him a coward? Does that make him a collaborator? Does that make him compromised in some way? I don't think so. I don't think we have the right to judge great artists that way. Mm-hmm. And I think that ultimately, no, I don't want to get into the Shostakovich wars, because they really are wars. And I don't want to go down the road of trying to interpret the intention or meaning of Shostakovich's music by trying to decode it, as some people do. I think that's essentially a sort of arid way of approaching music. I don't know if you'd agree, but I think the truth about Shostakovich is in his music. You only have to listen to his music to know the inner world of Shostakovich at the time he composes it, because his music says it all. You know, I had the privilege of knowing his son and grandson when I was a student hanging out in Manhattan, and I kept in touch with Dimitri, who was a really great pianist, the grandson, for a while. But I remember listening to the Oistrakh recording of, which is, I think, obviously the only recording you really can listen to of the Shostakovich, the first violin concerto. Are there two violin concertos? Yeah, there are two, aren't there? With that you know, that slow movement, which is just, you know, as Dimitri says, I mean, he's crying. I mean, it's the closest thing you can do musically, I think, to just crying. Mm-hmm. In sound, which is art. And you know, so why do you need to impose verbal meanings on that? I mean, it speaks for itself.
We don't have time because we have to finish. I wanted to talk about a production of The Nose by Shostakovich I saw in Munich last year, where everybody has multiple noses. So the strange thing is having one nose, so it's just the opposite of Gogol's story. It was a stage by Kirill Serebrennikov, who was arrested at home in Moscow. And in fact, he directed the production on Zoom.
Interesting.
We don't have time to go to that. You have said a lot about the story of Russia. I want to point out that you wrote the book before the invasion.
I did, yeah.
You did it during the lockdown.
It was my lockdown
and
book.
Only you had to update the end of the book.
Yeah, I mean, I delivered the book thinking, well, that's another job done in November of last year. And then, of course, the build-up and the invasion. So the publishers, we agreed that we would aim for a deadline of, I think it was the 20th of April, thereabouts, in order to get it out in time for the beginning of September and to allow foreign publishers to work with it from, you know, a finished typescript. Yeah. But I don't think I would change very much since April. I mean, essentially, at the end of the book, I outline what I see as the three possible scenarios for this war to continue and end, possibly. Mm-hmm. And I don't think anything really has happened on the battlefronts to suggest I would change that.
Mm-hmm. You begin the book with the unveiling of this huge statue of great Prince Vladimir in 2016, the same year we published our reviews of Julian Barnes and the speech by Putin. I was curious, more than curious, to read this you wrote for the Financial Times, How History Caught Up with My Russian Academic Friends. We cannot go through that. Only maybe read the end. One day we must hope the Putinist regime will be removed. At that point, it is to avoid repeating it, Russia will depend on a new class of leaders from the scattered ranks of its intelligentsia. These are the Russians who should be our friends. I think it's a great conclusion for all the points.
I think it's a good conclusion for the evening, indeed.
Yeah, well, this is this hideous concert in Palmyra with Gergiev conducting the Mariinsky Orchestra.
Well, shameful.
Yes, shameful. This gives for very good comments, but we don't have time.
No.
This I want to translate for you. This is a cartoon published in a Spanish newspaper, El País, last week. And the translation is, there's a man reading a book, and the translation reads, I am studying Russian in order to read Pushkin and to insult Putin, but I am being accused of fraternizing with the enemy. Which I think is absolutely brilliant. And then this was about Brexit, connected to another of your mother's books, sex and subterfuge.
Oh, sorry, I talked too much and...
No, don't worry.
And didn't stick to
your
PowerPoint.
Did you know this about Brexit? 48% sense and sensibility, 52% pride and prejudice. Uh-huh. This is absolutely fantastic.
There's quite a good line
fantastic.
I read on Twitter the other day that now basically the country, Britain, post-Brexit, is divided between those who are pissed off that, you know, and depressed because Brexit happened and it's too late for anything else now. Yeah. And those who are pissed off because Brexit happened and it didn't give them what they wanted. So it's a very... Yeah. Yeah, grim, your mother unhappy writes, country at the moment.
Your mother writes a lot about Jane Austen in the book, so that was the connection. And now we got to the end. This is something, this was Russia's troubled soul, organized also by Financial Times.
Indeed.
And it's funny because Anthony Vivor is presented by Financial Times as historian and author, and you are presented as author and historian.
Ah, right. Well,
and this takes me to the play you just mentioned,
you,
which will be the end
play.
Of our
thank
Cosmopolitan
you.
Dialogue. Yeah. This will be premiered in London in...
Premiered? I mean, it'll be performed, whether it's a premiere of any run or not.
And Flaubert is there, and I guess that Turgenev is also there.
I mean, this is really a spin-off of two things, of the work I did on the Europeans, where I just sort of fell in love with Flaubert because... Mm-hmm. He's such a misanthrope and says all the things that I believe myself. And I just love his writing and his letters. And so I just wanted to spend more time in his company, I guess. But I thought that I'd have a go at because I'm now retired, I thought I'd like to spend the rest of my days, as they say, exploring other forms of writing and dramatizing historical subjects on stage is something I'd like to do more of, because I think it's another way of getting history across and dealing with ideas, which is, you know, gives me more freedom as a writer. And it seems I can, you know, my first attempt is being produced, it seems I can do something with it, which is doable, you know. So I'm really excited about it. And the other thing that really excites me about it is that, you know, as a scholar and a writer, you know, I get enjoyment from teaching students, but I don't do that anymore. And I get great pleasure from talking to audiences and meeting readers. But otherwise, it's a fairly lonely business, writing. And but, you know, what I'm really looking forward to this is we start rehearsals in January. I'm going to be absolutely on heaven because I'm going to be with five actors, a director, a lighting designer, a stage designer, and various other people all discussing my work and how to produce it on stage. It's going to be fantastic fun to collaborate with people in creating something. So I'm really looking forward to it.
Fantastic. So this was it, Dr. Feiges. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank
for
you.
For sharing
Thank
all your ideas.
Thank you very much for such an interesting
Thank
conversation
Thank you to this
me.
Respectful audience.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you.